Currently, the Sahara Desert is one of the most inhospitable places on the planet, but this wasn't always the case. The sands of the Sahara hold secrets of the past that you couldn't possibly imagine. There are ancient lost cities lurking below its surface, giant lakes which once nourished a lush savanna landscape, and new evidence suggests the Sahara may hold a clue to the location of Atlantis. Join us as we dig through the sands of time and uncover the hidden world beneath the Sahara Desert. The Sahara is massive. It spans almost all of the northern section of the African continent. The desert is around 3.5 million square miles in size, making it one of the largest in the entire world. And although the dunes and sheer extent of the Sahara are impressive, it's what lies beneath its sands that is perhaps the most astonishing aspect of this part of the world. Deep under the sands of the Western Sahara is the reminiscence of a mega lake that formed around 250,000 years ago. When we look at the Sahara today, it may seem that there could be no possible way the region contained vast amounts of water, but we now know that it actually did from evidence collected by scientists. Hundreds of thousands of years ago, the Nile River passed through the Wadi Tushka region of Egypt. When it flooded, the waters covered a vast area of the Sahara. The craziest part is that the lake itself might have been over 42,000 square miles. This means that it was the second largest lake in the world. Scientists have uncovered fish fossils underneath the sands of the Sahara, around 250 miles away from where the water of the Nile flows today. This just shows how much area the mega lake covered in the region. Archaeologists have even found ancient human remains that correspond to a location of the lake. This was likely a vital resource for our ancestors as they made their way across the arid landscape. It would have been like a giant oasis that beckoned travelers to stop and rest on its bountiful shores, and was the only reason humans could settle for any period of time in this section of the desert. The lake was also likely a key location for the migrations of humans out of Africa. Without the once vast lake and waterways feeding into it, humans may not have been able to reach the Sinai Peninsula and travel into the Middle East, where Homo sapiens then spread to the rest of the planet. It might have been better for the planet if the mega lake hadn't existed and humans never made it past the Sahara Desert, but hindsight is always 20/20. There are a surprising amount of human structures and artifacts hidden underneath the sands of the Sahara Desert, and recently new evidence of human activity around the Rishat structure in the Western Sahara might prove to be the remains of one of the most sought-after lost cities in the entire world, Atlantis. The Rishat structure itself is incredibly impressive. This geologic feature has a series of rings extending outward from its epicenter, which is similar to how Plato described the city of Atlantis in his writings. To be very clear, the Rishat structure is not man-made. It's actually a natural geologic feature known as a domed anticline that's eroded to expose the flat rock layers between the rings. This feature was formed when a volcano erupted long ago and the magma cooled in a dome shape. The magma hardened and then began weathering to form the concentric rings of the Rishat structure today. The oldest of the rocks in the structure are located in the outside rings, with each inner ring being younger the closer you get to the center. The Rishat structure is around 28 miles across and made up of both igneous and sedimentary rocks. But the real question is, could this impressive structure in the Sahara Desert actually have once been Atlantis? The Rishat structure is located in the country of Mauritania in West Africa. The biggest problem with this theory is that Plato claims Atlantis was swallowed up by the sea. And since the Sahara Desert is, well, a desert, there's very little water to have flooded anything in the area. However, we know that the Sahara wasn't always just a desert. In fact, as you'll come to find out, the Sahara looked very different not too long ago. Perhaps there was a large body of water in the region that flooded the ancient civilization that resided within the Rishat structure. Maybe this is what the tale of Atlantis is based on, and Plato just exaggerated parts of the story to get his point across. Either way, there would need to be human remnants within the Rishat structure if it could even be considered as the location of Atlantis. The region itself is not safe to conduct comprehensive excavations in due to political and social unrest. It's also difficult to reach due to the remoteness of the region. This means that archaeologists have not had the chance to mount any type of serious expedition to test for artifacts or buildings within the Rishat structure. Yet, technology has been making tremendous advances over the last several years, allowing archaeologists to survey areas without putting boots on the ground. Scientists have been able to map several anomalies within the Rishat structure that are clearly the foundations of buildings that were constructed long ago. There were also reports of Stone Age tools, spear points, and other ancient human artifacts that have come out of the Rishat structure. It's worth noting that there is no evidence that an advanced Atlantean civilization thrived within the rings of the Rishat structure, but the fact that there was a human presence is very intriguing. Many people believe that the concentric circles match the description of the city of Atlantis that Plato gave in his Timaeus Dialogues. Archaeologists and other academics are skeptical of this conclusion. Until more research can be done and a large-scale excavation with the Rishat structure is conducted, the secrets hidden in this part of the Sahara Desert will remain a mystery. What is not a mystery are the discoveries of countless other archaeological digs in the Sahara that have uncovered some of the most incredible caches of artifacts from across human history. It's these excavations that have provided deep insight into the civilizations that called the Sahara their home. In the Libyan section of the Sahara, archaeologists have also relied on satellites to identify what lies under the sands in some of the hardest-to-reach places of the desert. It's here that they were able to uncover remnants of an actual once-lost civilization known as the Garamantes. These people built giant forts and extensive settlements in the desert. What is most impressive is that the structures were built thousands of years ago. The sands of the Sahara have since reclaimed the settlements, but archaeologists have found pottery, tools, and a number of artifacts that show these fortresses and settlements were built by a very powerful native African kingdom. The most impressive aspect of the Garamantes sites is how densely packed they are. There are agricultural fields, cemeteries, and fortifications, all within a relatively small area. This suggests that the population was relatively large. On top of the advanced urban planning, the Garamantes had a cutting-edge knowledge of metallurgy, manufacturing high-quality textiles, and recording information using a unique writing system. The deeper archaeologists dig at the Garamantes site, the more incredible the findings. It's clear that these fortifications and towns belong to a state-level society, which in the sands of the desert would have been a difficult thing to maintain. Large populations in a region of the world that received very little rain means the Garamantes had advanced ways of extracting water from the ground. It's hypothesized that this advanced ancient civilization turned patches of the arid Sahara Desert into oases that could support entire populations and aid traders as they traveled through the area. Unfortunately, the advanced irrigation methods and ability to transform the desert into lush fields likely led to the downfall of the Garamantes. What is buried beneath the Sahara is oftentimes a lesson in the extent of human hubris. As the Garamantes continuously pumped water out of the ground, they eventually bled their water sources dry. There was not enough rain to replenish the groundwater in the region, and the underground stores became as dry as the sand on the surface. As this vital resource dried up, the Garamantes civilization began to collapse. The water they needed to grow crops such as wheat, figs, and grapes was no more. The Garamantes people began to walk into the desolate Sahara Desert in hopes of reaching lands rich with water. Perhaps many of them made it to the Nile Delta. However, it's likely a large number perished on the journey or were consumed by the desert storms that buried their once vibrant civilization. This leads us to the crux of what has been found under the sands of the Sahara. Although it's a harsh environment, people did and still do live in the desert. But in order for these people to survive, trading needed to occur between settlements. Larger empires, such as the one in Egypt, desired valuable goods that were transported across the Sahara. And whenever there is movement of valuable metals, spices, and luxury items, things are bound to get lost. Take the ancient city of Timbuktu, for instance. This thriving settlement became one of the most important stops for trading across the Sahara. Large expeditions would be launched from the city, containing goods from gold to salt. But with each journey, there were inherent risks. The desert can be dangerous, and not just because water's hard to come by or food is scarce. Throughout history, bands of raiders would hide along trade routes and wait to ambush caravans when they passed by. The traders were already exhausted from the journey, and if they did not have the right protection, they'd be slaughtered and their goods stolen by thieves. Other times, gigantic sandstorms with walls of dust reaching thousands of feet high and lasting for hours would consume entire trade groups. In these circumstances, it was easy for a caravan to get turned around and lost in the desert. There's little doubt that massive amounts of goods, including gold and precious gems, have been claimed by the desert. However, finding them in the vast wasteland would be nearly impossible. But if someone were to get lucky, there would be untold amounts of wealth sitting below the sands of the Sahara. Although not everything is lost, we know exactly where some of the most valuable and impressive treasures in the Sahara are located. The Valley of the Kings. This is where almost all of the Egyptian pharaohs and high priests of the 18th, 19th, and 20th dynasties were buried. Their tombs were constructed in the eastern section of the Sahara Desert, where gold statues, precious gems, and beautiful art were buried along with the deceased. Sadly, most of the tombs in the Valley of the Kings were either looted or destroyed long ago, But the desert might still hold some secrets from ancient Egypt. The ancient Egyptian dynasties were unparalleled in the region for their might and wealth. The main reason for this was because of the Nile River, which served as the lifeblood of the empire. The Nile provided water and fertile silt for the Egyptians, which allowed their civilization to thrive and grow. However, many of their most impressive monuments were constructed in the desert. The pyramids of Giza lie only 11 miles from Cairo, but seem to be drifting out into the sands of the Sahara. There are pyramids and temples spread across Egypt that have been dug out of the desert sands. Pharaohs needed a secure place to be laid to rest, and they certainly weren't going to accept being buried in a common grave. Therefore, elaborate structures and tombs were built to house the remains of the most important rulers of Egypt, and as places to worship and honor the gods. Take the Temple of Hatshepsut, for instance. This was a magnificent structure built into the Sahara to hold the remains of Hatshepsut, who was the daughter of Thutmose I. Hatshepsut built this massive temple to tell the story of her life and reign. She wanted it to be the most elegant structure in all of Egypt, and she might have succeeded. Yet over time, and like everything else in the Sahara, the sands reclaimed it. The ruins of the temple still remain today, and they are still a sight to behold. However, it makes you wonder what other ancient Egyptian structures and treasures lie just below the surface of the Saharan sand. But Egypt wasn't the only civilization to build pyramids and monumental structures in the desert. Around 2,000 years ago, the Kingdom of Kush ruled from Sudan all the way to Egypt. They built their own pyramids and temples into the Sahara, which have been dug out from beneath its sands. Those pyramids were built after the pyramids of ancient Egypt. However, they show that the people who inhabited the Sahara have left countless structures for archaeologists to discover across the landscape. Surprisingly, if you travel far enough and dig deep enough, there are ancient Roman structures beneath the desert as well. The Sahara might seem like a long way from Rome and not someplace the Romans would want to expand their empire to, but if you sift your hands through the sands of the northernmost reaches of the desert, you'll find walls and fortifications built by the Romans. These are part of the Fossetum Africae, or African Ditch. Some claim that these fortifications extended over 450 miles to defend the southern border of the Roman Empire. At the height of Rome, its borders extended across the Mediterranean and into Africa. This southern frontier was important because it allowed the Romans to procure goods from the caravans traveling through the Sahara, along with exotic creatures coming from deeper within the African continent. This included animals such as lions, elephants, jackals, ostriches, hyenas, cheetahs, and panthers. Roman elites would keep these animals as pets to show off their status, but they also served a more sinister purpose in the Colosseums around the empire. Gladiators would often fight African predators to the death, while crowds of thousands cheered at the brutal excitement. The Roman structures buried under the sands of the Sahara Desert were built to ensure that goods coming from Africa would continue to flow into Rome while also securing the southern boundary of the empire. So, it seems that no matter what part of the Sahara you dig in, there is something surprising just below the surface. But perhaps the most astonishing find of all is not gold or ancient buildings or even the tombs of the pharaohs. Instead, the true secret that lies below the surface of the desert is just how different the Sahara once was. Around 10,500 years ago, if you were walking through the Sahara, you'd be walking across lush grasslands with pockets of dense forests. That's right, below the scorched sands of the Sahara are the remnants of a once vibrant ecosystem that sustained all sorts of life. The craziest part is how relatively recent this environment existed. Unlike the mega lake from hundreds of thousands of years ago, in the eastern region of the Sahara, the bountiful ecosystem that spanned the northern part of Africa was present in the not-too-distant past. The savanna ecosystem could support giraffes, elephants, rhinos, hippos, and crocodiles. If any of these animals tried to survive in the Sahara today, they would be dead within hours or days. However, just over 10,000 years ago, these species could thrive in the region. How is this possible, you might ask? Scientists have discovered the answer to this question by looking beneath the sands of the Sahara and above their heads at the cosmos. Throughout Earth's history, there have been climate changes. This is due to a number of factors, from asteroids slamming into the planet to the wobbling of the Earth on its axis. It's this latter phenomenon that caused the Sahara Desert to be converted into a savanna ecosystem. To be clear, these natural fluctuations can have drastic effects on the Earth's climate over a relatively short amount of time. But that's not what's happening to our planet today. The climate change we're currently experiencing cannot be connected to the wobble of Earth on its axis or any natural phenomena. This is because the rapid speed at which our climate is currently changing is not natural and is occurring much faster than ever before. Also, there is abundant evidence pointing to human actions, such as the spewing of huge amounts of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, that correlates to the increase in global temperatures and the resulting changes in climates across the planet. On the other hand, evidence gathered from the Sahara indicates that over the course of Earth's history, the wobble of the planet on its axis has shifted weather patterns, and this is what changed the environment in the region 10,000 years ago. What happened was monsoon rain swept across the Sahara Desert, dumping huge amounts of water on the sands of the region. The reason this deluge transpired was that when the Earth's tilt changes even slightly, the angle at which the sun's radiation hits our atmosphere also shifts. When the amount of energy hitting the atmosphere intensifies at the same time as West African monsoon season begins, it can lead to rains covering the Sahara itself. And this phenomenon hasn't just happened once, it happens repeatedly because of the constant wobble of Earth on its axis. So as you dig deeper into the Sahara's past, there are indications that this now arid desert has been home to savannas, forests, and lakes. What scientists have discovered is that these changes to the Sahara's environment only last for a few hundred years. It's estimated that good times, when the desert turns into a hospitable landscape for both humans and other animals, do not typically exceed more than 500 years. This is why, when we dig into the deeper layers of the Sahara sands, there's no remnant of massive civilizations inhabiting the entirety of the desert when it was once a savanna. There just isn't enough time for a civilization to grow and thrive before the scorched landscape of the desert returns. But for animals such as grazers, there's another story. Since they follow the rains and go where the food is, the migratory patterns of animals that thrive on the African savanna almost certainly took advantage of the fertile environment of the Sahara for as long as it lasted. This is why if you looked beneath the sands of the desert in the right places, it would not be out of the realm of possibility to find the bones of grazers that seem out of place in a desert environment. But perhaps what's even more surprising than the fact that the Sahara was once a savanna is how it turned back into a desert. New evidence suggests sometime between 8,000 and 4,500 years ago, the environment in the Sahara took an abrupt 180-degree turn and rapidly turned back into the arid landscape we see today. Some scientists believe this change happened much too quickly to be explained by the natural shifting of the Earth on its axis alone. When they look at the data, researchers concluded that something was very wrong and that an unknown variable led to the re-desertification of the Sahara, even though it should have remained a savanna-type environment for much longer. To find more evidence to explain this change, scientists dug underneath the sands of the Sahara to see what they could find. They collected sediment cores, pollen records, and some archaeological remains. An ominous pattern began to emerge from the data they collected. It seemed as if the initial changes in the ecosystem began in the more fertile regions of the Sahara, where humans had domesticated animals and allowed them to graze. It was here that the plant diversity first decreased. Whenever humans and their livestock crossed the savanna landscape, they would leave a wake of destruction behind them. The animals would consume the grasses, leaving only barren dirt behind. This ground would be baked by the sun and wouldn't be able to retain enough water to allow grasses to regrow the next season. Slowly but surely, the Sahara savanna turned into the Sahara Desert. More evidence still needs to be collected from beneath the sands of the Sahara, but scientists warn that the overgrazing of livestock can have detrimental effects on any grassland ecosystem. This means that the same desertification process that happened in the Sahara could potentially occur in other parts of the world as well. Wherever overgrazing occurs, the amount of atmospheric moisture decreases due to the lack of plants releasing water back into the air. This decreases humidity in a region, resulting in less rain. Then a negative feedback loop begins. Less rain means fewer plants can grow. With fewer plants growing, the air receives less moisture, which results in less rain. It's a vicious cycle that eventually leads to an arid landscape such as a desert forming. It's important to note that the Sahara would always have turned back into a desert due to the nature of Earth's wobble on its axis. However, the savanna landscape likely would have lasted much longer if human activity hadn't caused the degradation of the landscape by overusing the savanna ecosystem. Either way, Africa now has the third largest desert in the world after the Antarctic and Arctic deserts. Beneath this sand are still mysteries that need to be solved and secrets that need to be uncovered. Now watch scientists reveal where the Garden of Eden is, or check out real reason ancient Egyptians went extinct.